A Concise History of France by Roger Price. Read by Mark Meadows for Naxos Audiobooks. Introduction. The entity we know as France is the product of a centuries-long evolution, during which a complex of regional societies was welded together by political action, by the desire for territorial aggrandizement of a succession of monarchs, ministers, and soldiers. There was nothing inevitable about the outcome. It was far from being a linear development, and we must try to avoid a teleological approach to explaining its course. The central feature was the emergence of a relatively strong state in the Île-de-France and the expansion of its authority. Our task is to explain how and why this occurred. The invitation to write a book covering such an extensive chronological period raises prospects both attractive and daunting. It represents an opportunity to set the normally more restricted concerns of the professional historian within a broad historical context, but also creates major problems of perspective and of approach. Questions will always be asked concerning the extent to which it is possible to reconstruct the past from the remains it has left behind, R.J. Evans. The evidence historians have to deal with is made up of fragments, often chance survivals, which need to be contextualized in an effort to reconstruct their meaning. Every history is selective, but none more so than a work covering so many centuries. The problem is what to select, how best to make sense of the chaos of events, of the succession of generations that is at the heart of history, and how to define historical time and the shifting boundaries between continuity and change. A descriptive, chronologically organized political history would be possible, but would run the risk of turning into a meaningless catalogue of great men and their acts. The emergence of social history from the 1920s, often associated with Marc Bloch and Lucien Febvre, founders of the so-called Annales school, required even the political historian to set great men and the evolving institutions of the state within the context of changing social systems. As historians continued their self-critical dialogue with the past and debated the relative importance of economic, cultural, and ideological factors in the process of social formation and change, a proliferation of approaches developed. The appealing simplicities of a structuralist, class-based, and neo-Marxist approach, associated in the 1960s and 1970s with Fernand Braudel and Ernest Labrousse, were rejected as overdeterministic and leading to a reductionist neglect of the historical actors of culture and of community. A determination to integrate the poor into the historical record was followed by a desire to recognize the significance of gender and ethnicity as keys to the explanation of choice and behavior. The insights of social anthropology have also been deployed to create an awareness of the importance of language, images, and symbolic action in the construction of social identity, and of a cultural history that assumes that ideology, rather than society and the economy, is central to the human experience. In the absence of general laws of historical development, and as a result of a greater awareness of the sheer complexity of human interaction, a crisis of confidence developed amongst historians. This deepened in the face of a challenge from a post-structuralist and post-modernist philosophy associated with Michel Foucault, Jacques Derrida, and others, which, at its most extreme, emphasizes that every perception of reality is mediated by language, that every text has a range of possible meanings, and that historical research itself is nothing more than a reflection on discourse. If the past has no reality outside the historian's representation of it, it follows that reality cannot be distinguished from its representation. History thus becomes merely one literary genre amongst others, little different from the novel. Valuable in encouraging historians to question their assumptions, a post-structuralism that challenges the bases on which the social sciences have been constructed, including the belief in a verifiable knowledge and the value of empirical research, has ultimately to be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.